I'm Chris Pavlovich, and I'll be hosting these collaborative discussions for the next school year. Our first discussion is about connecting science and engineering practices to STEM fields. Just to give you an idea of what I can see is that I can't see you because of the way that this is set up, but I can see if you are chatting. So part of our norms and protocols for this PLC is that if you have a question, if you could put it in the chat box, and then we could start doing it that way so that we're not kind of talking over each other. And then we'll have more of a formal question and answer session where we can look at each other on the webcam so I can see you guys too. And so if you wanted to introduce yourself in the chat box, that would be good for people who are watching the recording as well. So this is a lot about networking so they can see who you are, where you are, and what you do, so that if you say something or they think that they might be able to connect with you in some way, they would be able to have some way to do that. And so today is about connecting science and engineering practices to STEM fields. We're going to focus on particular practices throughout the year, both comparing practices and looking at specific ones as well. Today, since it's the beginning of the school year, a lot of what we're doing is in elementary school is procedures and getting to know our class. And then in older grade levels, definitely setting those expectations high and thinking about practices for the next generation science standards, as well as Montana state standards and our National Research Council recommendation of standards being part of student performance expectations. And so if students are expected to perform them, they should at first know what they are and then get a chance to practice those practices. And so I'm just going to give us a focus point of something to talk about, a way that we can introduce this to our students. But we could also talk about how you would introduce this to your students, how you might use my idea or what you do in your classroom, because the professional learning community, a big, huge part of this is collaboration. So the conversation is very, very important. The first thing that I do with my students is introduce them to practices and how they're connected to life. And so we're really looking at practices as means to solve problems. So when we tell a student to think critically or problem solve, what does that mean? And what National Research Council did was asked engineers and scientists, how do you solve complex problems? And they came up with this list of practices, science and engineering practices. A way to do this is have students watch a TED Talk about engineering. If you Google them, there's 111 engineering TED Talks that are labeled engineering and then countless beyond that. So there are a lot of different ways to bring that in that could focus directly on what you are teaching. And, you know, 7 through 12 science teacher, you would be focusing on your exact specialty. So what your topic focus is, what your disciplinary focus is. For me, I focus on water and watershed education. And so we look at the TED Talk from Boyan Slat, how the oceans can clean themselves. And he's launching one of the most enormous ecological cleanup projects that has ever taken place. And he was 19 when he conceived the idea. I was told when I was in fifth grade that it was not solvable, you know, and so somebody figured out a way to solve it and was younger than I was. It was pretty awesome. And so from there, students can research their own engineers that are practicing and what they do to be able to solve problems. And you can ask an engineer to come in to your classroom and talk to students on how they use this. It takes a little bit of time, but most of the time I find that a student knows an engineer or a scientist, or I can reach out in the community and work with that person to talk about what they're doing. So I'm going to share with you a PowerPoint that a man named Josh Norquist made. And so we'll get into his PowerPoint, but he came in and talked to fifth graders about how he solves problems using science and engineering practices. And so this is the beginning of his PowerPoint. And you can see he's got his company name on there, and he labeled it engineering and problem solving. And he graduated from Montana State University and was a Livingston student. And lucky for him, works in Hawaii now. Hi, Bill. Awesome. And this is about, it says about me, but it's actually about Josh Norquist. He went to Eastside Elementary School and Sleeping Giant Middle School. So it's all right here in Livingston where I'm at. And then graduated from Livingston High School and graduated from Montana State University. And so he is a Montana graduate that went through our K-12 system, went to MSU, and then is practicing engineering in the field. And so what does he do? His company is a lot of wastewater, building, mining, chemical, power, and transportation. But really a huge percent of it outside of oil, gas, and chemical is designing transportation, and that's what he's doing in Hawaii. The particular project that he talked to my class about was a pontoon project, and so this is a floating bridge. And so problem solving using the practices. This is a reminder of what the 8 practices are. And then I'm going to ask all of you to participate in this next situation here, in this next slide. And so for defining a problem, and you can type, you can share out. Since there are only 3 or 4 of us, I think it should be fine to probably just share out. For defining a problem, if he's building a bridge and building a floating bridge, let's look at these. How do you think that he is defining problems according to PowerPoint? And you can type or you can talk. My wait time is really, really good. You can wait.
I think the obvious problems would be looking at the amount of traffic you'd expect on the bridge. And then also with it being floating, you have to take into account the salinity of the ocean, how that could affect the structure and also the weather and things like that.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that was Bill. Thank you, Bill, for jumping in. Absolutely. We also have developing and using models. And something that I hadn't thought about for the classroom application to this is that he wants the most basic solution to the key problem. And so they're really looking to get to the root of the problem, make that problem as simple as possible, and then make the solution as basic as possible as well. Let me show you some other key parts of this. And so for developing and using models, he is really using computer simulations as well, since his models are fairly complex. And then he's using hand-drawn sketches. What do you see as far as the conversation in the classroom and giving students buy-in to these practices? And it's, Michael says that cost and aesthetics, everyone wants a pretty and cheap bridge. Absolutely. Taxpayers are happy with what they're paying, don't want to pay very much more, and we want it to be beautiful. So those are part of defining problems as well. Good points. So as far as being able to engage students in practices and showing them what this looks like in the field and as far as solving problems, do you think that this helps with student buy-in? Yes or no, and why?
So Chris, is the question referring to just using models and developing them? And
I think the question is more towards science and engineering practices in general, just starting to get into this PowerPoint and the conversation that we are having, looking at how one gentleman solved problems within a company and worked together to solve problems with other people. Do you think that this would help students with buy-in as far as putting time and energy into practices in their class?
I think it totally does, because I think it shows them that it's used in the real world and that people that, you know, they're using this every day out in their jobs, and it actually makes a difference for a lot of other people. Something like a bridge, a lot of people don't necessarily think of all the work that goes into it. But the fact is that we have these people doing it all the time and using the practices. So I would say it's 100% going to help get buy-in for kids to see how this is used.
Yeah. And so Michael brings up a good point about student buy-in and getting them involved. And we think that that's excellent as well. And so giving them a STEM activity, or especially if you are looking for engineers that are tied into what you are studying in class. I really focus on water. And so looking at Boyan Slat and what he does to clean up the oceans, and then looking at bridges, is really applicable for my studies in my classroom. And so the studies for you might be a little bit different. And we'll talk about that after the presentation is over and see what we can come up with as far as community outreach. All right, and so planning and carrying out investigations. And so these are, especially the soil strength investigation, is something that I wouldn't necessarily think about. And these are just two. If I had to estimate, I would think that they probably did dozens and dozens of investigations to build this bridge, and it probably took a lot of different people. But I'm just gonna go through this one a little bit more quickly. And what I really like about this slide is that he is showing he's showing how they modeled and separated and looked at categories of data, and then it really gets you to thinking about how do they make decisions with that data. Because something that is often confused, and we focus on this in a later PLC later on in the year, is the difference between analyzing and interpreting data and using mathematics and computational thinking. And so when we're using mathematics and computational thinking, our real focus is modeling with mathematics, whether that's using a computer simulation or maybe a formula, or even, you know, building a bar graph or a pie chart or whatever that is, the model is using mathematics and computational thinking, whereas analyzing and interpreting data is making decisions based on the work that you've done, based on the modeling and the conversations that you've had. And so looking at this slide got me to thinking about how they're stacking all of those different soil samples in comparison, and looking at the traffic flow in different places, and what all of the different decisions that they had to make based on those, based on their numbers. Okay, so using mathematics and computational thinking, he has some graphs here, and my students were like, worksheets, they do worksheets in engineering? Because I don't know if you see it right here, it says that it's an engineering company worksheet is what it says. It's just something that they are using for that. And he has a lot of his formulas and variables. And so any conversation or thoughts that are sparking in you about analyzing and interpreting data and mathematics and computational thinking from this example.
Or just can you give me an idea what's on it? What is he looking at? It looks like, what's the graph of on the left?
It's about design values and tributary lengths, distributed load on a stud, the span length between reactions, inertia, there's a repetitive member factor and load duration factor. And I blew it up, but it doesn't sound like you guys can really see that. So when I move, it doesn't move.
So for me, when I think about these two, you know, I think about a lot of the labs we do in high school biology, and using the math and computational thinking part, I usually think of as just the data collection and the results that we're getting from that data. And then at the end, when we write our conclusions, is where we're really looking to do that analysis piece. And so oftentimes, you know, when we might run like a statistical chi-squared test for math, and that would go in that section, and then later they would tell me what that chi-squared test actually means. And I think that this becomes one of the trickier parts to actually get your students to do is the analysis part. I think most of our students are really good at collecting data, and they're really good at that using equations if you give them the equation, but once you ask them to explain what it means, it becomes really difficult and how they can apply it to another situation.
As far as making a decision too, you know, whether that decision is that you are looking to construct an explanation or design a solution or deciding what really the result is of the investigation, making a claim. I agree with that. And even asking students, my students have been coding and writing algorithms for different things, and to get them to commit and write it down, because they have an idea, right? But it's just this kind of more vague idea that's spinning around for them. But once they have to write it down and be specific, they're stuck. And because you really have to commit to words and make sure that those ideas are clear and concise to be able to write them down in word form and commit to what you're writing down. And I think that that is the block when we're analyzing and interpreting data and giving students some vocabulary and tools to describe mathematical models in a clear way helps with that, but we've got a lot of work to do. Is that making sense to what you're saying?
Yeah, I totally agree. Yeah, I often will notice that students will put things in their analysis that they can't support with their math too. So it kind of goes both ways. So there's this disconnect between what they think they can interpret and what they actually can interpret from the math that they're showing. And I think that, you know, it starts at a young age, but it's something our college students, and as a college student, I struggled with.
Yeah. And, you know, I wonder if, you know, it's what they want the results to be compared to what they actually are, you know, and that math is not subjective. You know, having a mathematical model, it's not subjective, which is why we use it. And even though we do have, you know, planning and using or developing and using models, we have using mathematics and computational thinking. We have a whole different practice for mathematical models that really says something about the power of that, you know, so that it is objective and it's there and it's hard numbers. You know? And so it's interesting that we have two different practices for that. To be super specific. And then it seems we have Connie who's joined. Connie, if you want to introduce yourself in the chat box, just, you know, say where you are and what you teach so that we have a little bit of an idea of who's around. Go on. And it looks like I... you know, you could practice, but as soon as you... there we go. All right. So constructing explanations and designing solutions. This looks like another model, but really what it is the prototype, right? And so the prototype of the solution of what they came up with and what he called the most simple solution to the target problem. And again. And then this slide was powerful for my students in a way that is a little bit unexpected, because I think when, you know, when they're thinking of argument and we really talk about academic argument, taking away the emotion and presenting evidence and reasons and being respectful to opinions and talking that out, I think that they almost expect a grandstand, like a debate. If it's outside of the school, at least in fifth grade, I think that's what they expected. Like they're just sitting around a table and that's what it looks like. You know, so you have adults collaborating, sitting around a table with just white pieces of paper, and they were looking for something, I think, a lot more complex or showy. And so when we focus on engaging in argument later this year, we'll talk about specific strategies to get students to kind of leave that emotion out of it, back up their ideas with evidence, and look at some problem-solving, problem-based cycles of units that can be used at different age levels. So obtaining, evaluating, and communicating information. When he stood up to talk about this, and he was going to be here today, and so I'm kind of disappointed that this isn't his voice coming through, and I'm trying to talk to you in the same way that he talked to us, and it's just, it doesn't translate as well, but he wasn't able to come. He said that without this piece, if he wasn't communicating with his team, nothing would happen, and that this piece was maybe the most important, and that the evaluating verb in there is something that is missed a lot of times, where it's not just copy it off of a website or copy it off of a computer or dictionary or encyclopedia or whatever they're using. Encyclopedias are very outdated, but we remember that as kids. But actually evaluating the information, making it your own, and being able to communicate it in a meaningful way. So going a little bit more. And then he shows some results of the work. And I want you to think about what sort of resources you have in your own communities as far as STEM teachers or STEM fields, I should say STEM fields, that are around you. Everybody has, you know, civil engineers, that sort of thing. But I want you to think of what connects to what you're teaching so that we can brainstorm some ideas. And how do we introduce practices to students in a meaningful way where it's applicable, it's outside the classroom, and as a means to solving problems? Please tell me you're seeing the pictures move, right?
I see pictures moving.
That's it. Then this picture summed up how large the project actually was and how many people were working on it, the kind of collaboration that took place. And his take on this was that these are the teams that had to communicate with each other. And to communicate between that many people takes a lot of organization, a lot of professionalism, and a lot of problem solving in itself. So, and then he had an opportunity for people to ask questions. And last year was the first year that I had gone beyond TED Talks. So the first time I was trying to engage students in STEM in the field outside of the classroom, because really to be able to solve problems and think critically and do the world good or just their job or within their families, you know, we need to problem solve. Not everything is on Google, you know, so being able to solve new problems and come up with new solutions to complex problems. Asking them to do that, a lot of them in fifth grade, part of it is perseverance, grit, you know, that passion is difficult to find. And so it's trying to take it and show them this is what these practices do. This is how adults will think critically and problem solve. And these are actual tools that you can use. And so that it started with just TED Talks, and I would show them Boy and Slat. And so if you've spent any time with me in a classroom, you've probably heard about him, because he's like a hero. He does such awesome things for the world and our environment. And students are really passionate about that, because we're talking about watershed education. And so it's something that they get into. And they particularly like that I didn't think the problem could ever be solved. And I was told by adults that the problem could never be solved. And then, you know, he solved the problem, and it was about the Great Pacific Garbage Patch and figuring out how to pick that up. And then the year after that, I asked them to do some research and find engineering TED Talks. I gave them a bank on our website, and they were looking at TED Talks, and you know, there were robots and origami, there are origami microscopes now, and all sorts of different solutions to problems that it's really infinite to think about. And they're identifying practices on a graphic organizer and filling those in. And so they were able to connect that to their own interests. And then last year, which was the third year, that I was really trying to push it outside the classroom and introduce this as a procedure that I would with anything else, I had somebody come in and talk about it. It seemed to have the biggest impact because it was a real person. And, you know, he just looked like a right. I think, you know, engineers sometimes they think are kind of the same image as a mad scientist, at least in elementary, or that they drive trains and so that they wear their striped overalls. And so that in itself just was powerful. And so I'm going to kind of open up the conversation because it's hard to get started, especially the first meeting. But, you know, PLC, we really want this to be collaborative and to be a discussion. And I'll give something for us to focus on and it won't always be a PowerPoint. And hopefully it's not a PowerPoint very often. You know, this is kind of a special circumstance. But I'll give us a focal point to start the conversation. But a natural progression of what we're finding in our classrooms and what we're looking at. And we have all the way from second grade to 12th grade represented just in the few people that are here, as well as, you know, administration at the state level. And we have a trainer and in science practices. And so we have quite the very various audience members to participate. So I want to ensure that we have time to do that. And so I'll start the question with, what are you seeing in your classrooms when you are looking to start discussing practices? Have you done that yet? Is it something that you want to pursue? Is it something you already do? You can share in the chat or you can give the microphone and do it audio.
I'll go ahead and go first then. So I introduce the practices primarily with my upper level students, which would be juniors and seniors, by doing lab reports primarily. And so we talk about what those practices are, and really all I try to provide for many of our lab activities is the question. And then from there, I let them, you know, kind of go through those steps on their own. And then at the end, I have them write a formal lab document that shows how they were using the practices essentially to come up with whatever conclusion that they're going to get from that material. And so, like I was mentioning earlier, oftentimes they're trying to make claims that don't match what they actually did and things like that. So I can definitely see that there needs to be time spent on my part teaching them the individual practices instead of that compilation as well, and kind of pulling them out bit by bit. That's the main way that I try to introduce it. Just listening, though, to Chris talk about having the engineer come in, I can already think of people in the community here, especially like the wildlife biologists that work with the tribe, and how I could bring them in. And, you know, like the big project up by Arlee was adding some of those animal corridors and how that process took place and the research that went into doing that, the research that they're continuing to do. I think is a good example of the science practices in practice for the students to see. So that's something that I now, just from listening to Chris talk about that, I want to make some phone calls.
That's awesome. That's such a connection to place for those students too, because they see those, they drive underneath them and know that they're helping. And so that's excellent. It sounds like you do a lot of reflection with your students about practices, right? So they're reflecting about what they've used and how they're doing that.
Yeah. And one of the tools that I've been trying a little bit more this year to improve our analysis of our data is using the claim evidence reasoning writing style, especially with my sophomore students, so they get familiar with it. So when they get into those upper grades, they're ready to write it more of a scientific level.
Have you ever looked at an engineering analysis report, or do you focus mostly on the lab reports?
I primarily focus on the science aspect versus the engineering, even though oftentimes there's some engineering that goes into their investigation in the science, but I haven't had a chance to look at those other reports.
know that there are a couple of, you know, on different technical universities, and they'll give you the template that they use. And so I've even kind of adopted those, not adopted, adapted. There we go. I'm pressure cooked a little bit. And so I've adapted some of those university engineering analysis reports for fifth graders and given them very specific words in there that helps prompt them. And since they are engineering, they seem to be a little bit more technical, but it lends itself to looking at those mathematical models a little bit more in detail rather than the sections of the lab report from what I've seen. And so I can maybe share those with you too, or I mean, they're just on a university website. I'm sure my fifth grade version would not be good enough for what you're doing, but hopefully by the time they get to you, then they'll be ready, right? That's, you know, the purpose. and so Connie and Michael, do you have teachers in the school that are looking at practices, or is this something that you're just starting to look at? Where are you at on this spectrum?
So this is Michael. I've been involved with the Next Generation Science Standards for quite a while here. And I've been using for a lot of time in my classrooms and stuff. In the elementary, I know a number of teachers here have been working through them and working to engage students in the different practices and stuff. And I think just getting people to come in, like you mentioned, bringing in engineers is a great way to connect to some of those. I do a lot of engineering activities in my classes, and sometimes some of those practices are hard to get to. So if I'm doing, kind of issue a challenge to kids and they're building a bridge or something, I often end up defining the problem and saying, you're going to use paper, it's going to be this long, right? But if you bring in the engineer and say, here's my project, then the kids can talk with that engineer, and then the kids have the chance to define that problem. And so it gives you avenues to address some of those practices by bringing a guest in. And I know, like, this is a good format too. If it's difficult for you to find a local scientist and engineer, I've had a friend that now works for Boeing as an engineer, and we've just done, turned the webcam around, pointed at the classroom, and then the kids can talk to an engineer like that. And we get people that are not necessarily in the area that work in different fields to come to visit the classroom.
Yeah, awesome. And so are there people in your community? I know is your Boeing person somebody that you think would be a good fit for your content? Or is there somebody in the community, just to give some people ideas that might be kind of floundering and thinking about, what do I do? Who do I contact? Do you have something that comes to your mind from your position teaching?
Well, when I've done that particular friend, I have an engineering elective, and that fits in there nicely for high school kids.
Okay.
I'm struggling what I would do for like middle level or a lower elementary. But I think if you find the right person that can speak at that level and has some experience working with a younger audience, my friend in particular kind of spoke over above my high school students quite a bit. But, you know, you get the right person in there that can speak to that right age group and make connections with people that work in the Forest Service or at a university. They can talk and then incorporate them.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense as well. And I'm looking, and Connie, where are you in your school and as far as practices go? Let's see. Oh, okay. And so Laura meant you to bring it here. And that makes sense. There are TED Talks that are geared for kids. And so a good place to start is there. And so that's where I started, was looking at TED Talks that fit the content. And so there are ones that are geared directly for kids to look at. And so they'll have like a dinosaur robot and trying to get the dinosaur to do different things. And they'll talk about kind of how they did it. And bringing that in, or Fish, Wildlife, and Parks as well. definitely helps out with that and being able to identify the practices more, I would say, for them, and having a conversation about it seems to help. And we've done Fish, Wildlife, and Parks as well when they design their fish letters, which has been, so, you know, they're coming up with all sorts of different ideas to get fish over dams and around all this apparatus that we build all over the rivers. And so that has been really interesting as well. And so, Michelle, do you want to talk a little bit about your rockets and how you engage practices with your rockets that you're doing?
Can everyone hear me? I'll assume you can. So I can only see Chris nod. I'm part of a grant sponsored by NASA, and so I get this horrible job of going around and launching water bottle rockets. And I work with Jamie Cornish at MSU, and she does the Estes chemical rockets. The water bottle rockets are more geared for middle school, kind of fifth to maybe sophomores, just because of the learning content geared for the chemical rockets seems to be much more high school from my perspective. But how I've been using the presentations with teachers is I've been working with them on having them build the rocket and looking at how many, then having them get together and naming how many practices they're actually engaged in while they're doing that. And then for just your basic science core ideas, like if you had fifth graders, a good way, like when they get the rockets and they go really far in the air, they're very, very excited, even the grown-ups. But they automatically start naming variables, whether they understand what a variable is or not. They automatically say, well, if I would have made a cone, it would have gone better. If I would have done my fins a different way, it would have gone better. If I would have given it more air pressure. Anyway, I think you get the point. But that's a great way to teach. As far as science goes, it's not a standard, but if they don't understand variables, they're going to be lost early on. And I just, when I was little, I struggled with variables because they were independent and dependent, and they were always taught at the same time, and I always got them confused. So, anyway.
And Connie, kind of a twist on that for second graders is I know that they do like save peat, and so, or a moon landing for Oobleck, and so they're trying to design something that can land on Oobleck and then take off again, and so it doesn't sink in and get stuck. And it doesn't, it is able to land and stay there and then come back off. And being able to look at that question according to states of matter and define their problems and going through a guided investigation that way. I've seen some elementary teachers teach practices through, you know, Dr. Seuss and states of matter. So hopefully that gives a little bit of ideas. And then Michael posted some TED Talks that the Oobleck landings are absolutely a fantastic mess. And I've done paper airplanes as well, so paper planes technically. And so having students design three different planes, measure their distance, and we've done this with adults as well. And it's kind of a take on the rockets, but you need a lot less materials and a little bit less time, and so that they can see how far they're going and make their choices on their designs based on their mathematical models of their graphs. And so we have about 15 minutes left. I don't know that we necessarily have 15 minutes left as far as content, though. I'm going to be completely honest with you. We have kind of a lot went pretty quickly. And so do you guys have any questions at this point? Questions or share outs or anything?
I got one more thing here. And so my freshmen have an integrated science class, and we do a lot of trying to look at science as a big picture, science and engineering, and they do a lot of work on science literacy and developing science literacy skills through reading and writing. And I have them do kind of a larger quarter project where we're working towards writing a research paper later in the year. And they have to pick an article from sources that I have selected as we work towards identifying reliable sources. And they tend to pick science news articles that lend themselves to engineering. And these kids then do some kind of presentation. And so I had a kid here, he was working on these satellites that fold and then they expand. And we found this origami stuff. And so this is actually a kid that has an IEP and has some difficulties in other areas of school, but he's very good at this. And so we're using this. He's able to talk about the engineering design process that went into this and how they problem solve to produce an end product here. And so that's another way to bring in those STEM fields is through their independent research, giving the kids a range of sources that at that level, they pick something that works for them, is at their reading level and their interest, and then they present on that. And through that presentation, if you set up your grading criteria right, they're talking about the design process and how that problem was solved and how it impacts us as a society.
And so the audience, does the audience get pretty involved as far as the students who are listening?
Yeah, and we usually like the first quarter only present to the class, and then later in the year we have a senior community center that we go down to and we'll present to seniors, or I've presented to other staff members or other age group kids. And it really, because the kids picked their topic and they picked something that was interesting to them, they're very passionate about it and they get really involved. And yeah, the audience receives it very well. And it's great engagement for the whole class. And we get to work with all sorts of levels of communication through science and reading and writing skills.
Awesome.
Yeah, that is awesome. I think that'd be great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's so much engineering out there that's just already there to be able to research, whether it's a TED Talk or having students find out what those engineering projects are and presenting it themselves to the other classes are all great ways to get students interested in the practices through STEM and engineering, whether fields are just fantastic messes of oobleck landings. So
Connie, are you going to try the oobleck landing? No pressure.
Just thinking.
Yeah.
So Bill, are you going to contact some people that were involved in making the, I'm going to call them animal overpasses. I'm forgetting the name for them exactly. You think you're going to do that?
Yes, we've already contacted I've contacted Tribal's Wildlife Department last year. And so I have some connections with the Wildlife Department through the tribe. And so one of them specifically was going to take us up and check the trail cams with my wildlife bio class. But I think I'd like to also see if I can get them to do a little more of like a presentation or talk about the whole process, not just looking at the pictures, which is what the kids really want to do, but kind of spend a little more time seeing the whole process. They continue to use they have trail cams set up at several different crossings on the reservation, and they use it partly to collect data on who's using the underpasses and overpasses, but also to help with population counts and study. So it's a pretty extensive project that's still going on.
And the last time I had talked to you in length, you were talking about using the Salish and Kootenai report for, was climate change, correct?
Yeah, so I've used parts of that in my class, and they also have a report on the wolf population, and I've used a lot of the documents that the tribe has created as kind of primary sources in a way for our wildlife class.
Yeah, absolutely. And so we have some, you know, some ideas for biology in life sciences, talking about wolf populations, and I know that there's an awesome course on OPI, the hub that you can take that's self-paced. And I'm part of the way through it. I can't remember who the instructor is. Michelle, do you remember off the top of your head?
What was the name of it?
Or who created the course?
What was the name of it?
The wolf.
Oh, it's from the Montana Wild. They built that.
Okay. And so that's an awesome self-paced course that gives you a lot of other data, access to data and GPS data. It's amazing. And then, you know, looking at reading the comments at the same time after a whole day, I guess my multitasking is right out the window. So we talked about wolf populations and maybe fish ladders, fish, wildlife, and parks. They do a lot of engineering, both in stream restoration and construction of different apparatus for fish to get around dams and irrigation ditches and that. And then we talked a little bit about engineering as well. But for physical science teachers and earth science teachers, do you all have any ideas for them? You know, the climate, maybe you could talk a little bit more in detail about the climate change report that you had found, Bill, for those teachers so that they have that resource.
Yeah, I mean, I think with earth science, to me, the biggest resources other than this one would be like using the USGS and looking more at the earthquake activity of Western Montana and some of the fault stuff. And so there's lots of scientists that are local that are would be willing, I feel like, if we contacted them that for reach. So the document, though, that you're referring to, the tribe put together a climate change plan and how they want to treat the reservation lands and kind of what their outlook is on the impact of the flora and the fauna over the next 100 years, and how they think climate change is going to play a role in that. And so within the document, it even has a list of the scientists that helped create the document, where they got a lot of the research to do the document. And so I think once you start looking locally, in your area, there's always scientists in that area that are more than happy to share the information. But like Michael was saying, you almost have to let them know who their audience is going to be, because oftentimes they're used to talking to peers or people with similar degrees. So,
great. And that document is fairly extensive as well.
Yeah, it was almost like a 100-page document. It's on their website, and so I might be able to find a quick link to it.
Yeah, and then Michael's bringing up the National Weather Service, and NASA has a lot of resources on their website as well, tons and tons. I mean, teachers or students go to the NASA website and find an example of NASA using a model at some point that, I mean, you could find hundreds, you know, or asking them to look at NASA for specific, kind of where I go with that, to be completely honest. There's all sorts of educator resources on there as well. So, there's the link that Bill put up for the PDF. And so anybody who's watching at home can pause and copy that down and whatever they need to do. And I think that kind of wraps us up. I thank you guys for being a part of this. I know that it's really kind of easier to watch it later sometimes, but to be a part of it, the conversation, is you really helped that along, and part of a PLC is having the conversation and collaborating and networking. And so I really pushed for that this time and will continue. And I really appreciate your participation in that. So thank you very much. If you guys don't have any other questions, it looks like a statewide climate assessment as well.
I had a question, if you wouldn't mind. Where did you hear about the PLC? Just to help us out.
I got it on the Science eBlast email.
Okay.
It was sent out.
Okay. Great.
I was just logged on to the Teacher Learning Center, clicking around, wondering, I wonder if there's anything here that I could join that I'd enjoy over the school year. I just clicked around and found it. I was browsing.
Well, browse again this time next month.
Well, that would be awesome. And so as a reference for next month, our practice focus is developing and using models. And so we'll have a lot to talk about for that one. That one's really fun and seems to be the one that's the most concrete for both teachers and students to tackle. So thank you guys very much, and I hope to see you next month.